Hello children, good morning. So how are you all? I hope you are all doing good. In the previous class you revised two lessons in physics. In today's class we are going to revise two lessons in chemistry, that are atoms and molecules and solution. Okay, let's begin the revision. The first lesson we are going to see is atoms and molecules. So in atom and molecule, the first thing we are going to revise is the postulates of modern atomic theory. So according to modern atomic theory, atom is no longer indivisible, which means after the discovery of protons, electrons and neutrons, the theory says atoms are no longer indivisible. And atoms of same element may have different mass number. For example, isotopes. Isotopes have same atomic number but different mass number. Isobars are the examples for atoms of same different atomic number but same mass number. And atoms of one element can be transmuted into atoms of another element. And this process is done by a process called artificial transmutation. And atoms are not always combined in a simple ratio. Okay, atom is the smallest particle which can take part in all chemical reaction. So next we are going to revise how to find average atomic mass. Okay, average atomic mass usually we will find for elements that isotopes of elements that are occurring as isotopes naturally. For example, oxygen is occurring in three isotopes: oxygen 16, oxygen 17 and oxygen 18. Okay, so we need two things to find average atomic mass. One is the atomic mass of the element isotopes, another one is the percentage abundance. Okay, for example, oxygen 16, the atomic mass is given here and the percentage abundance is given here. Likewise, we have for oxygen 17 and oxygen 18. Okay, let's take this in consideration. So the atomic mass of oxygen is 15.99, AMU is atomic mass unit, and it is multiplied by the percentage abundance, 99.76. So whenever we say percentage, it is for 100, so divide it by 100, then we will get 15.95. likewise, if we do for oxygen 17 and oxygen 18, okay, so we get three values and add all these three values, which gives us the atomic mass of oxygen. So to find atomic mass of oxygen, we need to take all the isotopes of oxygen and their atomic mass and the percentage abundance. Then if we multiply and divide it by 100, by adding all the values, we will get atomic mass of oxygen, which is 15.999 atomic mass unit. To round this 15.99, we can take it as 16. So the atomic mass of oxygen is 16. Next, how to calculate relative molecular mass? This is quite easy, simple sum. Okay, for example, if we want to calculate relative atomic mass of oxygen, we know oxygen is an element which are made up of same kind of atom. So whenever we write oxygen, we write O2. So which means two atoms of oxygen are there. So 2 means the number of atoms into AR means its atomic mass. So it, just now we find the atomic mass of oxygen, that is 16. Okay, so 2 into 16 is 32 AMU is the relative molecular mass of oxygen. Then for carbon dioxide has one atom of carbon and two atoms of oxygen. So for carbon, the atomic mass is 12, and for oxygen, the atomic mass is 16, and we have two oxygen atoms. So 2 into 16 is 32, plus 44 gives us plus 12 gives us 44 atomic mass unit is the relative molecular mass of carbon dioxide. Then this is your book back question, children. CaCO3 gives, which means calcium carbonate undergoes a chemical process as a result, it decomposes into calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. Your first question is, how many moles of calcium carbonate are involved in this reaction? Okay, can you see calcium carbonate, CaCO3? If there is no number, which means it has only one. So we have one mole of calcium carbonate. Calculate the gram molecular mass of calcium carbonate are involved in this reaction. So calcium carbonate, CaCO3, splits the atoms. It has calcium, it has carbon, and it has oxygen. So for calcium, the atomic mass is 40, and we have only one calcium atom. So 1 into 40 is 40. Next we have carbon. Carbon also we have only one atom, and the atomic mass of carbon is 12. So 1 into 12 is 12. Then we have oxygen. We have 3 oxygen atom here in calcium carbonate. So 3 into atomic mass of oxygen is 16. So 3 into 16 is 48. So 40 plus 12 plus 48 gives us 100 grams. So 100 gram is the gram molecular mass of calcium carbonate. How many moles of carbon dioxide are there in the reaction? How many moles? Already I said, if there is no number, which means it has one. So we have one mole of calcium carbonate. Okay, this is also your book bag question, children. How many grams are there in the following? Okay, 3 moles of hydrogen molecule. See, this is hydrogen molecule. It has 2 atoms, so it is a molecule. So how to calculate? We have 2 atoms, so 2 into atomic mass of hydrogen is 1. So 2 into 1 is 2. Okay. Now how many moles we have? We have 3 moles of hydrogen molecules. So 3 into what we found is 2. So 3 twos are 6 grams. So 6 grams of hydrogen are there in 3 moles of hydrogen. Okay, next we are going to see about solubility. What is solubility? A definite number of grams of solute, which means a specific number of solute should be needed to dissolve in a particular amount of solvent at a particular temperature and pressure, that is called solubility. And how to find out solubility? Solubility can be found using a formula called mass of the solute divided by mass of solvent into 100. See, if you say, for example, 36 gram of sodium chloride to be dissolved in 100 gram of water to form a saturated solution at 25 degrees Celsius, which means only 36 gram of sodium chloride can be dissolved in 100 gram of water at 25 degrees Celsius. If any one of these will changes, then it won't be saturated solution. For example, instead of 36 gram, if we have only 16 gram of solute, it is unsaturated. If we have a more than 100 gram of solution, then it won't be a saturated solution. So at a particular temperature and pressure, in a given amount of solvent, only a particular amount of solute can be dissolved, that is solubility. So 36 gram of sodium chloride in 100 gram of water at 25 degrees Celsius gives us saturated solution. If it is more than 36 gram of solute, then it is super saturated. Okay. Thus, the solubility of sodium chloride is 36 gram. Next, factors affecting solubility: nature of the solute and solvent, effect of pressure, and effect of temperature. See, nature of the solute and solvent. Okay, only a polar compounds dissolves in polar solute dissolves in polar solvents. Non-polar solute dissolves in non-polar solvents. Okay, that is the nature of the solute. Then effect of temperature. Okay, it is easy to dissolve sugar or salt in hot water than in cold water. That is because of the temperature. As temperature increases, the solubility also increases. So in endothermic process, the solubility increases with increase in temperature. In exothermic process, the solubility decreases with increase in temperature. So effect of pressure, this you can see, you can experience this when you have a soft drink. okay, when you open the soft drink, you can see bubbles comes out. That is due to the pressure inside the solution. Okay, that is why the pressure is inside the solution is to make the solute dissolve in the solution. Okay, in the solvent. Okay, so when the temperature increases, the solubility also increases. So how to measure this solubility? The solubility of a solution can be measured in two ways. One is mass percentage, another one is volume percentage. What is mass percentage? Mass percentage of a solution is defined as the percentage by the mass of the solute present in the solution. So mostly when solute is in solid state and solvent is in liquid state, we use mass percentage. So how to find mass percentage? Mass of the solute divided by mass of the solvent. Mass of the solute divided by mass of the solvent into 100. So one mass is, and it can be expressed using unit WW, which means weight into weight. One weight is the solute, another one is the solution. Next, volume percentage. Volume percentage is defined as the percentage by volume of solute in ml present in the given volume of the solution. Okay, so volume percentage is expressed as volume by volume. One volume is the volume of solute and other one is the volume of the solution. So how to find volume percentage is equal to volume of solute divided by volume of solution into 100. What are hydrated salts? Some kind of salts Some types of salts, when it exposed to surroundings, okay, they absorb some water molecules from the surroundings, and you can see some moisture in the salts. Okay, without change in their physical state. Absorbing of water molecule from the surrounding is called hydration. So as they absorb water molecules, they become ions. Okay, and once they become ions, we call it as hydrated salts. See, this is there in your book back question, hot question. Okay, now consider here, we have a salt and the salt name is copper sulfate pentahydrate, because it has 5 water molecules in it. Okay, when you heat it loses, actually the color of copper sulfate is blue, but when we heat it loses its blue color and it becomes white color. That is due to loss of 5 water molecules which is present in it. Okay, see, that is why it says pentahydrate. Penta means 5. 5 water molecules are there. On heating it loses all the 5 water molecules and it becomes white color, anhydrous copper sulfate. Okay, and this reaction is reversible reaction. On heating it loses 5 water molecules, when you cool it gains the color again, it gains 5 water molecules again and it become blue color again. Okay, so what is hygroscopic? This is what I said, some substances when you exposed it to atmosphere, it gains some moisture and becomes, and without changing their physical state, you can see some moisture in the salts. Okay, those are called hygroscopic. So what are deliquescence? Deliquescence are the ones when you expose these substances to atmosphere, they gain water molecules from the atmosphere and they dissolve in it. Okay, the physical state of the substance will change. Before it will be salt in solid state, but after the absorption of water molecule, they'll become liquid. Those kind of substances are called deliquescent substances. So you have now we revise two lessons, children. Go through these lessons and take your term one exam. Do your term one exam well. Thank you.
Children, you will be having end of term one examination from 7th September onwards. The portion for science exams will be laws of motion and optics in physics, atoms and molecules and solution in chemistry, plant anatomy and plant psychology in biology. Learn all these five lessons for your science term one examination. All the very best, children. Do well all the exams. Thank you.